American institutionalized racism is perhaps best showcased in its lack of reform and effective punishment for police officers who kill non-dangerous people of color. Activist Reverend Dr. Desmond Tutu stated it thusly, "You are neutral in situations of injustice, you have chosen the side of the oppressor." Therefore, American citizens have an ethical responsibility to combat police brutality that systemically targets citizens of color and must do so not only as individuals, but as part of larger organized groups in order to fulfill the equalities, rights, and freedoms ensured in the Constitution of the United States and those set out by the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights in 1948. So what has changed, and how do we change with it? If our morality and pursuits towards utopia are attempts to improve, as Caney suggests, where do we begin? Simply put, the form of the modern civil rights movement has changed. No longer are the largest active campaigns for justice spearheaded by leaders and rooted deeply within the church and neighborhood communities, but rather organized and spread through online exposure. With the advent of technology, police brutality and the racism it showcases is more realized and polarizing than ever. However, there is a problem with hashtag activism. It rarely manifests itself into physical, political, social, or economic action by most Americans. As individuals, most Americans are apathetic participants in the struggle. Uncomfortable with discussing race for fear of being labeled a racist or a revolutionary, it complicates Giddens' paradox. Instead of Giddens' paradox or Max Bernstein's proposal, I offer that the intersection of institutionalized racism and police brutality are an obvious issue that is suppressed because of the lack of constructive conversation, not because it is seen as a faraway threat or because it creates an imaginary threat. Individual ideological frameworks are firmly set in place, and advantages and higher moral knowledge do not persuade those morally offended to the suggestion of police reform to join in reform efforts. Although individual action must be taken, the shared responsibility, which can then be divided into varying degrees of responsibility and courses of action for each group, belongs to media coverage, the government, the police, and activists. The conversation needs to evolve. We must look past simply assigning blame for past oppressions and indiscretions, but push instead for effective action, of collective action, that will positively contribute to our present and to our progeny. America has never had a solid conversation about racial injustice. Disparities are furthered by an interlaced, multi-layered network of norms, policies, and institutions, which are frequently modified to maintain and intensify vulnerabilities to communities not in power. As a result, we have an ethical obligation to begin a serious conversation with intent to inform the issue, to change a system that oppresses its citizens, to understand and to confront the different frameworks, and to learn to compromise tensions erstwhile implementing effective change. Instead of being able to unpack the racial bias inherent and taught to police officers, the media currently fails to discuss the historical and societal impact of racism in this country on forming different frames of thinking, and relies on constructed narratives that center around buzz phrases like thug, armed, rioting, and constructing victims as violent monsters charging police officers. To simply accept that the opinions of those intolerant to change must remain equal and respected by the media and progress slowly to a better society is unacceptable. Patience is not a virtue to continue to push onto oppressed communities, and that the media, as well as the other groups mentioned, must use their past and current privileges and platforms to enact change by becoming active in the struggle for equal treatment under the law and its enforcement. More complicated are the connected responsibilities of the government, legal obligations, and politicians. Using ideal theory, the Constitution and its amendments, and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, our nation signed, presents problems immediately. United States citizens are not free and equal citizens acting as a collective body, especially in the eyes of the law. Local and state governments must be internally charged with a commitment to reform and a dedication to representative fair juries, especially for indictment cases. In a collective sense, the police must take the greatest responsibility for their detrimental actions and structure internal trainings, reformations, and punishments of brutality, misogyny, and racism. Trainings must move away from utilizing racist generalizations as a foundation and severely punish offenders. Police departments must also open themselves up for outside criticism and spend additional time teaching less violent ways of de-escalation, as well as a better understanding of the laws they are charged to implement. This group must identify and negotiate reform within different framings of responsibility in order to find a path forward that maximizes the protection of suspects of color within constraints. Activist groups must learn to make their actions, organizations, and aims not only intersectional for this issue, but seek to understand how this interplay touches other facets of social justice. There are certainly more than enough examples, from excessive police brutality within public schools, to the murders of brown and black women, and the relative silence from white feminists, to the shootings of children, to the homeless men who've been killed, to the baffling and silent rise of lethal police violence against Native Americans, to the many handicapped persons of color who became victims of police brutality, and the many queer people of color whose murders are not labeled as hate crimes by officers. The obligations of justice extend and are grounded in the fight against structural social injustice, and as race is a conditional factor of everyday life, intersectionality and liberal activism must be more than a concept.